Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Shilpa S. Chapadgaonkar from Manav Rachna International University. Today, we are going to discuss about a module, Instrumentation in Supercritical Fluid Chromatography, under the paper Chromatographic Techniques 2. After completing this module, the students will be able to understand the historical developments in the field of SFC instrumentation. They will learn about critical requirements of SFC instrumentation. They will learn about the different types of components which are used for SFC. They will be able to know the different types of detectors, their compatibility, and their selection for any application. In the last module, we have understood the formation of a supercritical fluid. Supercritical fluid formation requires that the temperature of the supercritical fluid be heated to higher than the critical temperature. It is an important technique for separation of different types of complex molecules. We know that there are two different column types that are used in SFC. The first type is the open tubular or capillary columns, and the other type is the packed supercritical fluid chromatography column. We had discussed that carbon dioxide is the most popular supercritical fluid chromatography mobile phase, and some other substances which are known as modifiers are added to the carbon dioxide to increase the polarity of the mobile phase. This helps in the elution of polar compounds from the column. So some other types of additives can also be added to elute the polar compounds from the column. In the packed supercritical fluid chromatography, modifiers are added to the mobile phase. Additives are other organic compounds that, when added to SFC mobile phase, increase the polarity and aid in elution of polar compounds. In this module, we will understand the basic instrumentation of supercritical fluid chromatograph. So, in this slide, we will summarize the historical developments in SFC instrumentation. The SFC technology could be applied practically in 1980s only after the commercial system was introduced by Hewlett-Packard. The popular SFC system of early times consisted of following different parts: capillary column, oven, pure carbon dioxide as mobile phase, pump for pressure or density programming, fixed restrictors to maintain the pressure, flame ionization detectors. However, the early equipment suffered from limitation of long retention times and low efficiency. Further developments in HPLC instrumentation also led to acceleration of development of SFC technique. In 1992, an advanced equipment for SFC was introduced again by Hewlett-Packard, which used packed SFC columns with pressure pump and back pressure regulator, that is BPR. The pump had a capability to deliver pressure and composition gradient. The role of modifiers and additives was studied in detail, and this led to application of SFC for analysis of various classes of compounds. In the last module, we had studied that the most important factors that govern the SFC separations are Mobile phase composition, its density or pressure and temperature. Therefore, a supercritical fluid chromatography equipment is designed to control flow, density and composition of the mobile phase over the course of the separation. The main components of the modern SFC system are solvent delivery system, injector, thermostated column, restrictor or back pressure device, also known as BPR, detector and data handling system. In this figure, you can see a typical supercritical fluid chromatograph. Carbon dioxide or other mobile phase is stored in a pressurized cylinder and modifier is kept in a separate reservoir. Two different pumps are used to pump the carbon dioxide, that is the mobile phase, and modifier in requisite amount to a mixer where the mixing in appropriate desired ratios is carried out. The sample is introduced into the injector. This sample is carried by the mobile phase flowing through the injector into the supercritical fluid chromatography column. The effluent from the column goes to the detector. The effluent from the detector is then may be discarded or may be collected using fraction collector. Solvent delivery system is responsible for the transport of solvent through the injector and further into the SFC column. Precise control of mobile phase flow rate is maintained by the system. It also helps to maintain the desired pressure of the system. Solvent delivery system consists of carbon dioxide pump, liquid modifier pump, and back pressure regulator. Pumps used in supercritical fluid chromatography. Mobile phase pressure is the most important parameter in supercritical fluid chromatography, as it controls the density and hence the solubility of the solutes in the mobile phase. Therefore, a good SCF should be able to maintain the pressure and pulseless fluid flow in the system. Liquids are easier to pump than the gases or supercritical fluids. In order to maintain the liquid phase, the pump head is chilled well below the fluid critical temperature. The cooling of the pump head is brought about by special chillers that are made up of an external circulating bath filled with fluid like ethylene glycol flowing through a heat exchanger attached to the pump head. Alternatively, thermoelectric or Peltier coolers can be attached to the pump head, which cool the pump head with heat exchangers and pre-coolers. However, only chilling the pump head cannot completely compensate for the compressibility or density at different temperatures and pressures of the supercritical fluid. Online filters and activated carbon or alumina adsorption cartridges are employed to purify the mobile phase prior to entering the pump. The pump design and seals are selected to tolerate very high solvent strengths and pressures. Typically, syringe pumps or reciprocating pumps are used for 1 microliter per minute to 10 ml per minute flow rates respectively. In this figure, you can see a typical schematic of a syringe pump. Syringe pumps are generally used for capillary columns and are known to provide consistent pressure of the mobile phase. These pumps consist of a big syringe, about 50 to 250 ml working volume, with a motor which drives a gear train and brings about precise displacement of the fluid. A transducer with an electronic feedback loop creates the back and forth stroke of the piston. Syringe pumps deliver pulseless flow but have a fixed delivery volume and require a refilling cycle. Syringe pump is a positive displacement pump consisting of a syringe-like chamber. It has a plunger that revolves continuously, which is driven by a motor. The motor action generates the continuous movement of the mobile phase that gets propelled by the revolving screw and pumps the mobile phase through a small needle-like outlet. Reciprocating pumps. In the figure, you can see a typical schematic diagram of a reciprocating pump. Reciprocating pumps are generally used for packed bed supercritical fluid chromatography columns since they facilitate the mobile phase mixing and addition of modifiers. Reciprocating pumps also need a back pressure regulator or BPR attached at the end of the supercritical fluid chromatograph in order to maintain the pressure of the system. The pump is operated at fixed flow rate, which fills a buffer chamber between the pump and the BPR. The flow to the column is bled off from the buffer. Working of the reciprocating pump. Reciprocating pump consists of a reciprocating piston that moves back and forth in an hydraulic chamber. The movement of piston makes the mobile phase flow into the column under high pressure. When the piston moves backward, the inlet valve opens and the exit valve closes. As a result, the mobile phase is sucked into the chamber. The reduction in volume of the chamber due to the forward motion of the piston results in mobile phase moving out of the exit valve under high pressure. Injectors. Injector devices or loop injectors are used to precisely deliver the requisite amount of sample into the column. Sample injection is done by delivering the contents of a sample loop into the mobile phase by means of an injection valve. The figure shows a manual injection system. The system has a load mode and an inject mode. In the inject mode, the sample from a syringe is injected into the loop. Then the injection is set to inject mode, where the loaded sample is left into the flow of HPLC or SFC mobile phase. The excess sample is transferred to a drain. So this type of injectors may have several loops of different volumes, such as 20 microliter, 50 microliter, and so on. However, when a sample of 25 microliter is injected into the loop of 20 microliter, then only 20 microliter passes through the column and remaining fluid is drained out. There are other types of injectors as well. For example, inline injectors, which are more versatile and offer flexibility for changing the volume of injection. A high pressure pump is required to inject the feed solution. The injected stream is dissolved in the eluent flow. Therefore, a sample is diluted before entering the column. In contrast, the in-column injectors permit the injection of feed directly into the column without dilution. Injector volumes. Small internal diameter of the open tubular columns demands extremely stringent requirement of injection volumes. The sample should be injected as a narrow band to prevent band broadening due to injection. Very small sample loops with volumes as low as 60 nanoliters are used for open tubular columns. It may require use of sophisticated splitting techniques for injection. So, the sample volumes for open tubular columns are typically less than 60 nanoliters, and for packed columns are somewhat greater than 1 microliter. The small internal diameter of open tubular column limits the sample size that can be loaded for analysis at one time. Since efficiency of separation in packed columns is not dependent on column diameter, the column diameter can be increased to increase the sample capacity. As discussed in the last module, the SFC columns are two different types, that is, K capillary or open tubular columns. They have narrow internal diameters made of fused silica with polymeric stationary phase coated on the capillary wall. The other type are the packed column, which contains small size particles, approximately around 5 micrometer size diameter of packing material contained in the stainless steel housing. The temperature control in SFC columns is achieved by thermostated oven. Precise temperature control is essential for SFC. Open tubular columns or capillary columns. These columns are generally smaller than GC columns, that is 50 micrometer in diameter and around 10 to 20 meters in length. They offer less theoretical plates as compared to packed bare supercritical fluid chromatograph. The analysis times in open tubular columns are generally high. The small size of these columns restricts the total amount of sample that can be loaded onto the column. However, it can be applied for separation of complex mixtures. Fused silica columns. Fused silica based columns are widely used as the capillary columns. These are made from specially purified silica with minimum metal impurities. Physical strength, flexibility, and inertness are the qualities of fused silica columns. Packed supercritical fluid chromatographic columns. Most common stationary phases used for packed columns supercritical fluid chromatography are modified silicas. Stationary phases that have been developed for HPLC can also be used for SFC, provided that 1. The stationary phases are stable under SFC conditions, and 2. The phases are inert with respect to the mobile phase. The most popular stationary phase are octadecyl, octyl, cyano, and amino phases. Specialty stationary phases for SFC include ethyl pyridines. For low polarity solutes, reverse phase columns such as C18, C8, C4, and methyl are sometimes used. Restrictor. A simple restrictor is most commonly used for capillary supercritical fluid chromatography in conjunction with gas chromatography detectors. Restrictor consists of a narrow bore fused silica capillary tubing. Pressure regulation by restrictor is brought about by flow resistance due to the length and diameter of the tube. Longer and narrower the tube, greater is the pressure maintained. So in this figure, you can see different types of restrictors used in supercritical fluid chromatographs. There are several types of restrictor designs. For example, linear, crimped, tapered, converging, diverging, integral, and fretted. These are typically installed before the detectors. The restrictors are prone to blockage, often due to the condensation of moisture from the sample that becomes frozen at the tip of the restrictor on the evaporation of carbon dioxide mobile phase. Therefore, devices are required to be heated to prevent the clogging. Back pressure regulators consist of a pressure sensing device and a needle valve. These regulators are able to control back pressure irrespective of mass flow rate of the supercritical fluid and therefore are more reliable than restrictors. Electronic regulator consists of a needle and a solenoid valve seat. This type of valve controls the flow resistance of the fluid by changing the gap between the valve needle and the seat. BPRs are installed behind the detectors to maintain the pressure throughout the SFC. The outlet of BPR is usually heated to prevent the adiabatic cooling of expanding carbon dioxide gas from forming dry ice, which may block the flow path. Depending upon the user applications and requirements, The eluent flow from the BPR may be collected or directed to a suitable fraction collector to isolate the individual separated compounds in discrete collection containers. Microprocessor. A microprocessor mechanism is placed in the equipment for SFC. This unit collects data for pressure, oven temperature, and detector performance to control the related pieces of the equipment. Operation of supercritical fluid chromatograph. The mobile phase is first pumped as a liquid. Before its entry to the SFC column, it is brought to the supercritical stage. Mobile phase flows through the injectors and transfers the sample into the SFC column and then into the detector. Back pressure regulator is placed either after the SFC column when coupled with GC columns or GC detectors, or after the detectors when using the UV visible detectors. Back pressure regulator is responsible for maintaining the supercritical state throughout the operation of SFC. During the exit from the chromatograph, decompression of the mobile phase takes place. It forms a gaseous and a liquid phase. The gaseous carbon dioxide is vented and the liquid is collected in the trap. The liquid waste volume is very small and less toxic. It is one of the advantages of using supercritical fluid chromatography. In this slide, you can see the wide variety of supercritical chromatography detectors. Typically, the detectors used for liquid chromatography as well as gas chromatography can be used for supercritical chromatography. The detectors used in SFC can be classified as 1. The detectors that analyze the solutes dissolved in the mobile phase, or 2. Detectors that analyze the solutes in the gaseous phase. The selection of detector is based on many factors. Prominent among those are 1. Whether the chemical composition of the mobile phase is compatible with the detector principle, or secondly, the volumetric flow rate which is evolving from the column is compatible with the detector cell volume. Pure carbon dioxide has extremely good compatibility with most of the GC and HPLC detectors. Relatively, more polar solutes are known to be separated by open tubular columns by using only pure CO2 as mobile phase. Therefore, it can be coupled with most of the detectors. However, in packed columns, organic modifiers are required for the elution of solutes having greater polarity. This creates issues with compatibility with detectors. Refractive index detector. The working principle depends upon the change of refractive index of the eluent from the column with respect to the pure mobile phase. It suffers from several disadvantages such as lack of high sensitivity, lack of suitability for gradient elution, and the need for strict temperature control, a pulseless pump, requirement for a pulseless pump or a reciprocating pump equipped with a pulse dampener should be employed in order to use the RI detector. UV visible detector. Some of the detectors are fixed wavelength while others are variable wavelength. The detectors which allow the selection of opening operating wavelength are called variable wavelength detectors, and they offer best sensitivity for any absorptive component by selecting an appropriate wavelength. These are more sensitive than refractive index detectors and they depend on the specific analytes and wavelengths. However, these are less sensitive than mass spectrometers, and the analyte must absorb in the UV visible range in order to give any signal. Mobile phases should not show high absorbance if we are showing Mobile phase should have low absorbance in order to use the UV visible detector. Some of the other detectors that are used in SFC are diode array detectors. It is a scanning wavelength detector. It can scan a spectrum of each solute as it elutes from the column. Electrical conductivity detector. It consists of two electrodes that respond to analyte in the mobile phase. Electrochemical detectors. They are very sensitive and respond to substances that show oxidation reduction. Fluorescence detectors. These are used for detection of material that fluoresce or fluoresce after derivatization. UV lamp provides the excitation wavelength. When this light is focused on the sample cell, the fluorescence emitted is focused on a photocell and the fluorescence is recorded. Various types of detectors for SFC have been developed. For example, flame ionization detector. It is the most widely used detector, which is based on the production of ions when compounds are burned and then detecting the current produced from the ionization. TCD or thermal conductivity detector. This operates on the changes in thermal conductivity of the gas stream brought about by the presence of analyte molecules. Helium is the carrier gas most often used with this detector because it has a high thermal conductivity. ECD or electron capture detector. It uses Ni63 as a radiation source to cause ionization of substance using nitrogen as the carrier gas. This detector is sensitive to functional groups containing electronegative species such as halogens, quinones, peroxides, and nitro groups. Hence, they are very good detectors for environmental analysis where pesticides need to be measured. Mass spectrometer. In mass spectrometer, the analytes are detected based on their molecular weight. The obtained information is especially useful for compound structure identification. It can be used to quantify very low detection limit of elemental and molecular components. So students, let us now summarize what we have learned in this module. We have discussed the important parameters that need to be controlled, such as pressure and flow rate, for the operation of a supercritical chromatograph. We have learned about the different components of supercritical fluid chromatograph, including pumps, pressure regulation, injectors, columns, and detectors. We have also learned about the factors that affect the selection of columns and detectors. Thank you.